My name is Neil Pugliese. I'm a hatchery biologist here at the John D. Parker East Texas Fish Hatchery. This hatchery is located in Brooklyn, Texas, here in East Texas. I've been here almost 4 years now. I'm a past graduate of the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff. I went through their master's program, and I graduated in 2007. We basically are responsible for raising fish for release in public waters. We don't do any private stocking. This is all for the state. This is the inside of our new hatchery building. Behind us, we have our hatching racks and some holding tanks. We raise largemouth, Florida strain largemouths, smallmouth bass here at this facility. We also hold rainbow trout, which we have in our raceways right now for our winter stocking programs. We raise blue catfish. We're the only hatchery in the state that has blue catfish brooders. We also raise bluegill, channel catfish, and we raise a lot of koi to feed all of our brood fish. And this year, for the first time, we're actually raising sunshine bass, which is a female white bass with a male striper. And that's the first time that we've actually had spawning success this year. And we actually just concluded that last week. And we stocked those fry last night. And that process starts with collecting the white bass females, and those all came from the Sabine River just north of Toledo Bend. The male stripers came from the Trinity River just below Lake Livingston in the tail race. Once we bring those fish into the building, we check them with a little glass tube. We stick it into their vent, take some eggs out of their ovary, and we check to see what stage of maturity they're at. Following that, they're injected and with HCG, and they're separated by how long we think those fish are going to take to actually spawn. So it'll be separated by fish that are within 4 hours, 6 hours, 8 hours, 10 and 12 hours. And we'll just periodically go back through there and check those fish. When we get one that we think is ready, we'll turn it over on its back, and if eggs are flowing freely, we'll take them and strip them into a plastic container, making sure that there's no water touching those eggs. If any water gets on those eggs, that the water hardening process starts and those eggs are actually adhesive and they stick to everything and you can't fertilize them as well. And you can't get them out of that plastic container to put them in a hatching jar. So we try to make sure everything is dry, there's no water present, and after we are done stripping those eggs into that plastic container, we'll bring a male striper over, dry it off, and put that milt into the container with those eggs, stir it for a few minutes, add water, stir it for a few more minutes, and after that, we'll put it in a hatching jar. And to remove that stickiness on those white bass eggs, we actually put it into a tannic acid solution. They'll stay in there about between 5 and 10 minutes, and while they're in there, there's air rolling them constantly to try to make sure that all the surfaces are exposed to the tannic acid solution. That removes the adhesiveness of those eggs. After that 5 to 10 minute period's over, we turn the water on and begin to flush that solution out of the jar. So we stop that process, because if you keep the eggs in the tannic acid for too long, the shells get hard and the fry can't hatch out. And at that point, it now becomes a 24-hour operation. Our crew is here night and day, watching the eggs, going through, adjusting the water flow, siphoning off dead eggs, and just making sure that there's no problems. Because this is actually a recirculating system that we're using. The water is not flow through. So we have pumps, we have air compressors, and we have everything that's running, and it needs to be running all the time. And we have redundancy so that if there is a problem, we can turn it on. But if there's not a person here to watch that, then that's possible. So our team really had to come together, work hard, be cooperative, and work a lot of really long days, because as soon as those eggs go in the jar, no one leaves them alone until the fry are in the ponds. So it takes about between 48 and 72 hours, depending on the temperature, for those little fry to hatch out of those eggs. One of the biggest challenges with this Sunshine Bass Project, besides just actually physically getting the eggs, getting them to be not adhesive and getting them to hatch, is getting them out into a pond that's actually able to support them. We're doing this in early February, and the water temperatures are pretty cold here. They've been averaging between 10 and 14 degrees Celsius. So for us, the big question was, how are we going to get enough food in these ponds for these fish to eat? The normal charts that you use for figuring out fertilization and when you're going to have peak rotifer production aren't going to really hold as true, because the water temperature is so much colder than people would normally do this at. So we decided to fill our ponds roughly 2 weeks early, get them going. We only filled them about a little more than a quarter of the way full, and we started fertilizing with cottonseed meal. Especially during this colder time of the year, we're kind of nervous about what our zooplankton production is going to be, and that's actually something I wind up getting up in real early in the morning before sunup. I get up about 5:30. Since I live here at the hatchery, it's only right out my front door. I go down to the ponds and I start doing my zooplankton sampling. and I'll continue to monitor those zooplankton populations throughout the production cycle. This facility has 64 ponds. They range in size from half acre up to 2 acre ponds. The 2 acre pond that we have right up here is where we house our blue catfish brooders. These are a smaller 1 acre pond right up here that we're driving by, and those actually contain our smallmouth bass brood fish we got from Colorado. We'll actually start spawning those next month. We'll bring them inside the building and let them get acclimated, and we'll actually raceway spawn those fish. Now we're headed over to one of the fry ponds for the sunshine bass that we stocked yesterday. We actually waited till late in the afternoon, right as the sun was setting, and to make sure the water was as warm as possible. Yesterday we had a good warm afternoon, so that actually helped bring up the temperature. One of the things we were really worried about, besides actually getting zooplankton to grow, was causing, by adding a lot of fertilizer, is causing pH spikes in the afternoon, which are also pretty bad for a little fry, especially sunshine bass fry. So we only filled this pond up a little less than halfway, so we have plenty of room to actually flush in fresh water. So hopefully, by the time these little guys get through their first couple weeks, when they're mostly eating just rotifers, and we get them to the point where they're eating feed, we can actually crank up the water, flush through there, and so that we don't have any pH issues. One last thing I really wanted to touch on in this little video clip was, by the time you become a hatchery biologist, a lot of the day-to-day stuff that you're used to doing as a technician, and you're not really doing as much physical work anymore, and you wind up getting stuck doing a lot of paperwork. I'm in charge of a credit card, and it comes with a huge amount of paperwork that you have to keep up with, all different types of reports I have to file and things I need to give to the manager and keeping up with the budget. And you don't realize as you progress in your career how much paperwork you're going to wind up doing, and it's getting organized at a young age. As you can see, if anyone went to grad school with me knows, my organizational skills haven't improved very much. And that's something that you should be really thinking about. I spend a lot of time in here on the computer, entering data, keeping up with our stocking reports and trip sheets. And it's just something that you don't really think about, especially when you're younger in this field, that at some point in your career, you'll actually make that transition from doing all the more fun fish-related stuff and actually becoming more of an office-type job. And here at Texas Parks and Wildlife, I guess I finally crossed that line.